was the most exciting time, would you say, in your career, or the most, how shall I say, from the point of experience, the most enriching period?
I would say the period in the AACM. As a young guy working with people like Henry Threadgill, Leo Smith.
Yeah.
That 3.5 years working with the AACM was profound and totally shaped my perspective and helped me in every way. I think that was the most exciting period in my creative life.
Yeah.
In terms of learning about the possibilities that existed, that had opened up.
Yeah.
After the great work of John Coltrane,
yeah,
great work of Carl Heinz Stockhausen for me, the great work of Jan Zanakis and Sun Ra.
Yeah.
These people have meant a lot to me in my life.
Yeah. Did you work with Sun Ra at some point in time?
No, I did not work with Sun Ra. I had opportunities to have communications with him.
Yeah.
But I was never a member of the Sun Ra Orchestra.
Yeah.
But I have always felt that their work was very important.
The guest appearance would have been nice.
I prefer to hear Sun Ra doing his own music, and I prefer to do my own work.
Yeah.
I didn't need to play with Sun Ra.
Yeah.
But I did need to learn from Sun Ra.
You appreciated what he did.
Yes.
Yeah.
Marilyn Crispell worked with me in a quartet with Mark Dresser and Jerry Hemingway. And then we worked together for 5-6 years,
yeah,
maybe a little longer.
Yeah.
And it was wonderful to have the opportunity to play with that group. They're all such incredible musicians. And it was a wonderful experience to work with them, and in working with them I was able to evolve my work because I had musicians who could execute.
Yeah.
And I have nothing but fond memories of Marilyn Crispell.
Yeah. A little bit. How was it for you during the extreme political upheaval in the States? During the movement of the...
Good question. The 60s was dynamic, and concepts of music and politics would go to the fore.
Yeah.
Concepts of the emergence of black music and black identity,
yeah,
would come to the fore. My feelings about the nature of that connection is complex. It became a little bit too easy to simply say black, 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 and to talk of music in racial terms. I was never interested in talking of music in racial terms because,
yeah,
I was always interested in composite reality.
Yeah.
And I also wanted to be able to listen to whatever I wanted to listen to.
Yeah.
And so I have, my influences are African, European, Asian, and Hispanic.
Yeah.
But in the 60s, it would be in the time period of the 60s where my work would become suspect. Is it black enough? Is it white? And is it too cerebral? And this kind of thing.
Yeah.
And more and more, when I think about this time period and the idea of authentic blackness,
sort of, yeah,
as opposed to, yeah, inauthentic blackness.
Yeah.
I would say I'm very happy to be an inauthentic black person, an inauthentic African person.
Yeah.
I see my work as separate,
yeah,
from the ethnic racial games,
yeah,
being played in this time period. My work is an affirmation of my love of universality and composite spiritualism,
mm-hmm,
and my work comes about through the experiences I've had. And the experiences I've had have been universal experiences, yeah, all around the planet. But it would be in the 60s where my work would suddenly be viewed as too cerebral, not black enough, and so this kind of thing.
Did you have problems with, I mean, I read things like, you know, he was not accepted by the jazz. What world, I don't know what that is, but they say something exists, the jazz world. I mean, jazz, I don't know if jazz exists either, because I think jazz is just a four-letter word. You can call it funk, and they'd say, okay, Miles Davis is the king of funk.
Yes.
What's the difference? I mean, okay, it's, who, you know, like, who used that word is more, maybe more the question. But what did you think, that, just go back, what do you think of the, how do you feel when people say, well, he's not really jazz or in this club?
Part of the struggle of my life has been the fight to claim the right of definition, the fight to advance my work in the way I wanted to advance it, and the complexities of having to finally understand that I could not change how the opposition would paint my music.
Yeah.
And in the end, it would make me stronger. Because one, the first thing I would give up was the idea of making money.
Yeah.
And once you give up the idea of making money,
you get quite powerful.
They can't do a lot to you.
No.
Two, I gave up the idea of having everyone like my music. I'm prepared to continue my work until my death with no one there.
Yeah.
I do it because I could not be alive.
Yeah, you need to.
I would not want to be alive,
yeah,
if I couldn't do my work.
Yeah.
And so your question for me goes back to self-realization,
yeah,
and what that means in terms of preparing yourself for the incredible spectra of reception dynamics that one confronts. We're talking now 40 years of me doing my own music.
Yeah.
And I'm not complaining. Mm-hmm. I think as a young guy, I would have hoped, like every person, that I could have a music career and many people would like it and it would be
popular.
This kind of thing. But
popular.
In fact,
popular. It's the word popular.
But in the end, you do the best work you can do.
Yeah.
And I would like for my work to be received, but I'm also very open for it not to be received.
Yeah.
Because the most important thing is
refusals.
Aesthetic honesty.
Yeah, refusals. They stand for something too. That's what I think you're trying to say.
Refusals stand for something, but what I'm trying to say is the dynamics of my experience would help me to better understand what it is I want to do. And it would help me to be able to face rejection or acceptance. Because both acceptance and rejection is an illusion.
They have their dark side and their bright side. That's what I was saying, really.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, to be refused is not something to be taken completely personal.
Yes, at a certain point you get used to one-star reviews or
right.
Could
be a guy who's in for you.
Max Roach would say to me, something like 20 years ago, that if I could survive academia and continue with my music, by the time I hit 60, there might be a possibility, things will start to change,
yeah,
maybe a little more work will come. Yeah. This is what Max told me. And in fact, this seems to be the case. There seems to be more possibilities,
yeah,
for work as I get older. And it's interesting because on one hand, I, of course, course, I'm still interested in performance, and I'm grateful to have possibilities to perform. But on the other hand, at 61, I'm moving on to 62, I don't want to perform as much as I did when I was in the 20s and 30s. I really would like to emphasize composition, research and development, and writing. And so it's, life is really something. Life is magical and majestic. I'm very grateful to be alive. But no, things seem to be changing in a way where I'm able to work a little bit more.